Hello viewers, I am Dr. R.V. Chittagopi from Classic IAS and KAS Study Circle, Dharwad. I am dealing with the subject history since 23 years, right from the inception of this institution. And today I am here in front of you to discuss some of the important aspects of history for your competitive examinations at all the levels and for all the types of the exams. So as you know that students, history is one of the vast subject covering from Indus Valley civilization to how we achieved our independence. So it covers a span of around about 5000 years. So which we are going to classify it into ancient, medieval and modern Indian history. However, for the convenience of the students and from the competitive examination point of view, I have chosen certain important topics of history where the questions can be asked in the examination. So keeping this in view, we will start here mainly the lectures on some of the important topics of history. Today, my topic is related to the Mauryan history. Mauryas, who mainly ruled from here 321 BC to 187 BC, from here 4th century BC to 2nd century BC. So the Mauryas were the first to build a vast empire in India. And when we say the Mauryan dynasty, the king whom we remember is the famous King Ashoka, who has been here designated in our history as Ashoka the Great, who is known for his yeoman services in different humanitarian fields. However, today I'll be discussing of Ashoka, how we are able to know his achievements. So what is the source? Because in history, source is the most important thing. Without sources, we cannot write the history. As Herodotus has stated, no sources, no history. So keeping this in view, which are the sources for the study of Ashokan here achievements? How we can come to know about the achievements of Ashoka? There are different sources, but the most important source for the study of Ashoka are the inscriptions of Ashoka, which are termed as the edicts of Ashoka. So we are going to study the Ashokan edicts. Today we will be taking this as the source material to know about the rule of Ashoka. So Ashoka here ruled. Ashoka here mainly ruled here from 273 BC to 232 BC. So around about 4 decades Ashoka ruled. And he got engraved the inscriptions here to make the people aware about his mainly the achievements, mainly about his moral values, mainly to know about Buddhism, and also here mainly here to here give the important events of his life. So the inscriptions provide us with a different information about Ashoka. So you can get a question on this mainly the topic, the Ashokan edicts. So here Ashoka was the first king in the Indian history to start engraving the inscriptions. He is the first ruler who started engraving these inscriptions. And they are popularly called as the edicts. So edicts means royal orders. The inscriptions are in the form of royal orders. Ashokan here edicts. They are the royal orders issued by the emperor himself. So these edicts here are all stone edicts. So they are carved on the stones. So hence we call them as the here stone edicts. So the orders of Ashoka are mainly here his mainly the here the edicts are on the stone. So usually we call it as the stone edicts, which have been classified as major rock edicts, minor rock edicts, cave edicts, and pillar edicts. This is the classification of the Ashoka's inscriptions. So before we go to this, what is an inscription? You have to know it. What does this here inscription mean? So inscriptions are the engraved writings on any hard material. Usually if we see in our Indian history, the inscriptions are of two categories. They are stone edicts or the stone inscriptions and copper plate inscriptions. They have been engraved on the copper plates, which we call them as the copper plate inscriptions. And the inscriptions engraved on the stones are called as a stone inscription. So engraved writing is an inscription. So that is how the word has come, inscription, inscribed. Inscribed means the inscription. So Ashokan edicts are all stone edicts, and they are mainly classified as major rock edicts, minor rock edicts, cave edicts, and pillar edicts. In this edicts, in these edicts, we find different scripts and languages have been used. The different scripts and languages that have been used in these, mainly the scripts. So why we find, why they are not in one language or one script? Because the heterogeneous people who lived in his empire, they must know his, mainly the, here the edicts. They must understand what he has said to the people. So what are his orders? So in order to make the people understand about his, mainly the information, what he has said. So that's why the known script and languages have been used. We have four scripts used: Brahmi, Kharoshiti, Greek, Aramic. The four scripts that have been used in Ashokan edicts. Where Brahmi and Kharoshiti is used, language used is Prakrit. The Prakrit language has been used where Brahmi and Kharoshiti scripts have been used. Greek script, Greek language, Aramic script, Aramic language. So we find here the four scripts have been used and three languages. Four scripts and three languages have been used in his edicts. This is mainly, usually you may come across in your examination the question, here how many scripts have been used? So then he may give you the name of the scripts and ask which of the script has been not used in Ashokan inscriptions. So for that reason, remember the four types of scripts used. But majority of the inscriptions are in Brahmi script. Most of the inscriptions, majority, are in Brahmi script and Prakrit language. Whereas a few inscriptions are in Kharoshiti, Greek, and Aramic. So this is one aspect to be remembered about the Ashokan edicts. The edicts of Ashoka today are located in five countries. Here, the edicts of Ashoka have been scattered in five countries today. They are not only in India, outside India also we have found the edicts. Mainly Afghanistan, Pakistan, Nepal, Bangladesh, and India. In five countries today we can see these edicts. So what is to be understood is Ashoka's empire comprised of all these, mainly the areas. So his empire expanded till here Afghanistan region, and in the east up to here mainly the Bangladesh what we have. So a vast empire here was there. So in mainly Afghanistan, Pakistan, Nepal, Bangladesh, India, in five countries you have got the edicts of Ashoka. The edicts of Ashoka were first deciphered in 1836 by a scholar named James Prinsep. James Prinsep was the scholar who deciphered means who read the inscription. James Prinsep was one of the linguistic expert. He was able to decipher Brahmi script and Kharoshthi script, and with the help of that in 1836-1837 the Ashokan inscriptions were read. So he was mainly responsible for mainly the reading of the Ashokan inscriptions. So edicts of Ashoka, if you take here today outside India, the most important inscriptions you have got outside India, I'll be speaking here in Kandahar, that is Afghanistan, we have found the edict of Ashoka. Kandahar, Afghanistan, what is the importance of this edict? It is a bilingual edict, that is a use of two languages. The use of two languages is there. It is a bilingual edict. So you can expect a question in the examination. They may ask you, which is the bilingual edict of Ashoka, where two languages have been used. So bilingual, we come across Greek and Aramaic here is used. Greek and Aramaic has been used in this Kandahar. Kandahar today comes in Afghanistan. Then Lumpak edict, which is near Kabul, Afghanistan. Lumpak edict. So the another important edict we have found in Afghanistan is the Lumpak edict, which is near Kabul. So it's the name of a place here near Kabul, or you can sometimes call it as the Kabul edict of Ashoka. So in Afghanistan we have found this. This is in Aramaic script and Aramaic language. The Lumpak is a Aramaic script. So one of the most important thing of this edict is it speaks about the construction of a highway from Lumpak to Pali-Botra. Pali-Botra is here Pataliputra. The construction of the highway has been mentioned in this edict, the Kabul edict. So that is what we can see, the trade activities were carried out here between these two places. Then we have the Shahbazghari edict, which is in Pakistan, and it is in Kharoshthi script and Prakrit language. Kharoshthi script and Prakrit language. So Kharoshthi script is one of the script which was used in India because of the influence of the Aramaic script. It has originated from the Aramaic script, the Kharoshthi script. Like Aramaic, Kharoshthi is also written from right to left. From right to left, we have the Kharoshthi script written, and the Prakrit language here has been used. But whereas, remember, Brahmi script is from left to right. This is Kharoshthi script example where we have Shahbazghari here in Pakistan. Then Ruminde in edict in Nepal, Brahmi script and Prakrit language. Ruminde in Nepal. Ruminde is a pillar edict. Ido Stambha Shasana. It's a pillar edict what we have got. The Ruminde in Nepal, Brahmi script and Prakrit language. This edict is very helpful to identify the birthplace of Gautama Buddha. So far in literature, Gautama Buddha was born at Lumbini, we have stated. But where Lumbini was located, we were unable to find the place. With the discovery of this here edict of Ashoka, Ruminde edict, or sometimes also called as a Lumbini edict in Nepal, we are able to identify the birthplace of Gautama Buddha. That information is gathered from this inscription, Mahasthana inscription or Mahasthana edict, which is in Bangladesh, Brahmi script and Prakrit language. So these are important edicts of Ashoka which are outside India. They are not in India, they are outside India. So the important edicts of Ashoka which are in India, today I am coming. So in India, which are the important edicts of Ashoka where we have found the inscriptions. The Brahmi script and Prakrit language is very common in Indian edicts. So Brahmi script and Prakrit language. So here we have Allahabad. Allahabad in Uttar Pradesh, the Allahabad edict of Ashoka, Saranath edict, Junagadh edict, Kalinga edicts, and the 13th rock edict. These are some of the important edicts in mainly India today. So why they are important, just in one sentence I'll be speaking. The Allahabad edict, which is called as the Queen's edict. This edict mentions about the name of the Queen of Ashoka as a Karovaki and the donation she made. So it is known as the Queen's edict, Allahabad. Today you know this Allahabad with another name as Prayagraj in Uttar Pradesh. Saranath, very popular here, mainly the edict we have got, the Saranath edict. This edict helps us to know that Ashoka was very tolerant to all the religions. It speaks about his religious toleration. Here in this edict he speaks, he never tolerates the people who bring the schism in the religion. One who promotes communalism in the religion, here that is not tolerated, Ashoka mentions in Saranath edict. Junagadh edict, which is in Gujarat, speaks about here the mainly the repair and here the construction of the Lake Sudarshan, here which had been built by his great grandfather Chandragupta Maurya. The renovation took place to this here the lake, that is mentioned in Junagadh edict. Kalinga edict, the Kalinga edicts which have been found at here Jaugad and Dhauli, so both are called as independent Kalinga edicts of Ashoka. That is, here the two edicts which inform about the welfare measures to be adopted by Ashoka. What are the welfare measures he will undertake? Humanitarian work he will do for the people of Kalinga. And the 13th rock edict, as most of you know it, that it is here the edict which gives the information about the Kalinga war, which took place in the 8th regnal year of Ashoka, that is around about 261 BC. The mainly Kalinga war is mentioned here. And along with that, in this edict we also have the names of the contemporary kings of the world mentioned with whom Ashoka had good relations. That is the information we get from the 13th rock edict. Also specifically, I am coming to Karnataka. In Karnataka, we have found the edicts of Ashoka at the places here, mainly the five districts. We have found it at Gulbarga, or today it is known as Kalburgi, Raichur, Chitradurga, Ballari and Koppala. In these five districts, we have found the Ashokan edicts. These are the five districts where Ashokan edicts have been noticed, which is an indication Ashoka's empire expanded till Karnataka region. Till Karnataka, the Mauryan empire had expanded during the time of Ashoka. So in Kalburgi, we have got one very famous inscription, Sannathi inscription. Sannathi, here is a name of a place in Gulbarga district. It's also a pilgrimage place on the banks of River Bhima, where we have found the Ashokan edict. The Muski inscription in Raichur district. The Brahmagiri inscription, Chitradurga. Nittur inscription, Ballari. And Koppal, we have got the Gavimat inscription. At Koppal only it is located, the Gavimat inscription. So five important inscription. Total number is 13 in Karnataka. What we have found, total number of inscription are 13. But these five are very important. You can expect the questions. Like Sanati speaks about the Dhamma of Ashoka, the moral values of Ashoka. Muski is an edict which has revealed the name of Ashoka. So far, right from mainly 1836-37, when the Ashokan edicts were deciphered, here many inscriptions of Ashoka have been found. But in none of the inscription he is mainly referred with his name. He has been referred as the Devanam Priya Priyadarshi. That is the title of Ashoka. Devanam Priya Priyadarshika. So with this here title, he has been mentioned in the edicts. But 1915, with the discovery of a Muski edict was discovered by here the scholar named Charles Bedden. He discovered this edict, and this edict gives the name of Ashoka. The Ashoka's name has here appeared here along with his title. That shows it is mainly Ashoka was Devanam Priya. Devanam Priya was the title of Ashoka, he is known to us. Likewise, Nettur inscription has also given the name of Ashoka, which are there in mainly Ballari district. Brahmagiri inscription, which is in Chitradurga district. It is in Chitradurga district, the Brahmagiri inscription. It speaks about the relation between the king and his people. How should be the relation between the king and his people? That is, here like a father and the children. Like the father and the children, the relation must persist. So this is mentioned in mainly Chitradurga. Or there is another most important information about Brahmagiri edict. So Brahmagiri edict has given the name of the scriber, Lipikara, that is Chapada. The scriber name has been mentioned in the Brahmagiri edict of Chitradurga. Chapada is the name of the scriber. So like this, Ashokan edicts have helped us to know about here these mainly the information we get. Now before we go to the mainly the visuals of these edicts, the Ashokan edicts. Here, today if you look at the Ashokan edicts, totally there are more than 150 edicts of Ashoka. Looking at here all the countries, 150 edicts are there. But based on the subject matter, if you classify them, you can find only here 33 edicts, because they are the repetitions. So what we have found in mainly here Afghanistan, the same edicts have been also found in India, because the people of India should come to know it, and the people here in Afghanistan must know the matter. So the repetition is there. So based on subject matter, only 33 edicts of Ashoka are there. And the 33 edicts are mainly like what we have, the 14 major rock edicts. The 14 major rock edicts are there. Then we have 3 minor rock edicts, 7 major pillar edicts. Then we have got here the 3 minor pillar edicts, then 4 cave edicts. Like this, totally we have 13 edicts of Ashoka. 13 edicts of Ashoka are there. Just as we have gone through the important edicts of Ashoka, just you can look at the here visuals of these, mainly the inscriptions here. Kandhar inscription, if you remember, I have told you, it is a bilingual inscription. The first part, what we have got, is in Greek. And this part here is in Aramaic. So in two languages, you can find this edict. It is a Kandhar edict, a bilingual edict. So Shahbazgari edict, it is completely in, as mentioned, Kharoshiti. So you have to read it from right to left. Right to left, the Kharoshiti here inscription. Then Ruminde pillar edict, which is in Nepal, which has here given us the mainly the birthplace of Gautama Buddha. So this edict, this is when the excavation took place. This is what we have got, and this is on the pillar. So this portion, what you have seen with a red mark, that is this mainly the inscription that has been found. This is has helped us to know about here the birthplace of Buddha. So Ashoka mentions in the edict, as this was the birthplace of the Shakyamuni Buddha, here he reduced the taxes on this mainly Ruminde village. That is what is mentioned in this edict of Ashoka there. This is Allahabad pillar edict. The Allahabad pillar edict, what we have found of Ashoka. Allahabad pillar edict is very interesting. Students, you can expect a question on this Allahabad pillar edict. That is, here you have to go through this edict, that is important. And this is Muskie edict, where we get the name of Ashoka. And lastly, the Brahmagiri edict, the name Chappada appears in this edict. So these are the important edicts what we have got. Mainly keep these edicts for your information and for further discussions, for more informations and for more knowledge to enrich yourself. Do join me at the classic online classes which we are going to start. And apart from this, I'll be discussing the other important here topics of history in my next class. Thank you.